The suicide last week of a transgender teenager in Ohio has drawn heightened attention to the challenges that transgender and lesbian, gay, or bisexual young people face, and prompted something of a national conversation on the subject. Hari Sreenivasan has our report.
Hundreds gathered at a candlelight vigil in Columbus, Ohio this weekend in memory of transgender teenager Lila Alcorn. The 17-year-old who was born Joshua is believed to have killed herself late last month. Alcorn's story gained nationwide attention after a suicide note was posted posthumously on her Tumblr page. In it, she detailed her struggles with her identity and placed much of the blame on her devoutly Christian parents, who she claims refused to accept her. She wrote, "The only way I will rest in peace is if one day transgender people aren't treated the way I was. They're treated like humans, with valid feelings and human rights." Alcorn said she was taken out of school and forced to attend so-called conversion therapy, where she was told to change her sexual orientation. In an interview with CNN last week, Lila's mother, Carla, said she loved her child unconditionally, but could not support her sexuality on religious grounds. During the interview, she referred to Alcorn using only male pronouns. Alcorn's death has sparked a groundswell of support, with many calling for a federal law to protect other transgender adolescents.
I hope that the conversation continues. We could have vigils every day from now until eternity, but if we're not actually trying to make changes within the system and within the institution, then I think we're going to continue to have children that take their lives.
Meanwhile, on Twitter, users shared support and their own stories of hardship with the hashtag #RealLiveTransAdult. And a change.org petition calling for the banning of conversion therapy has nearly 300,000 signatures online.
For more on the pressures on transgender youth, their friends and families, and what resources are available, we turn to Mara Keisling, executive director of the National Center for Transgender Equality, and Leo Sheng, a Michigan college student who recently transitioned from woman to man and chronicled it all on social networks like Instagram and YouTube. He joins us from New York. So, Leo, I want to start with you. When you first heard about what happened to Lila Alcorn, what went through your mind?
Well, I initially didn't read the article. I saw the headline. And it took me a little while to bring myself to read it. And I read her note, and it was just heartbreaking. It was really hard to finish it. She touched on so many different aspects of her life, and to share that, mm-hmm. It was just really hard to read.
Were there things that you could relate with, feelings that you had gone through yourself?
Yeah, she mentioned towards the end, either living as a lonely man or a lonelier woman, and that definitely resonated with me.
Okay, Mara, how common is this, not just depression, but suicidal tendencies in the transgender population?
Well, we don't know exactly. We do know that there is an elevated level of suicidality among transgender people, probably substantially higher than among non-transgender people.
How come?
Well, there are a lot of pressures that society puts on us. I think one of the things that Lila did so well in her note was to really express very clearly that it wasn't her. She wasn't the problem. It was how society was treating her. It was what the expectations were for her because she was transgender. And those pressures are really real. And that note resonated with so many trans people, maybe most or all trans people.
And possibly even other people besides that.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? Yeah. So, Leo, one of the things in her note that she pointed out specifically was the support or lack of support from her parents. When you were growing up, when you were going through this transition over the last few years, how important was that to you?
It was everything. I mean, without that support, I would not be here right now, honestly. It really provided a cushion for me. If I fell, I knew that someone would catch me, and I knew that I had people have my back. So I know for sure I would not have made it this far without the support of my family.
Mara, what about the support network that deals with the family members and the friends as well? Because as even in the grief-stricken kind of conversations that those parents had on a television network the other day, they still refer to Lila as a boy.
Yeah, you know, transgender people are not a new phenomena, but so many of us being out and so many of us coming out is really a thing of the last few decades. And there haven't been a lot of resources for parents until over the last couple decades, when now there's things like PFLAG, that's Parents, Friends, and Family of Lesbians and Gays, but they do a lot of work with transgender parents of transgender people as well. There's a lot of resources on the internet. There's the Family Acceptance Project. There's Gender Spectrum and so many other ways that people can learn. People have to reach out. What Leo said is so important. Family acceptance is one of the most important indicators of success or failure in any kind of life. But when you're facing some societal pressures, having your family behind you is really important.
And how, where does that fall short most? I mean, in this particular scenario, in the videos, or I should say in the suicide note, it said that the problem wasn't school, or her friend said she was actually accepted in school, but really the problem was at home. But for the majority of transgender people, is bullying more of a problem in outside the family?
Well, I think it's different. It's different for everybody. Some people have phenomenally supportive parents, and lose their friends. Some it's the other way. Some it's just people at school. It really varies a lot. It's getting better. Mm-hmm. It's not getting better for everybody fast enough, but it is getting better.
Leo, one of the things that we had talked about earlier, and you'd mentioned in one of your posts, was just about changing the pronoun. And how mm-hmm. important that was. Why is that so important for somebody watching somewhere else that doesn't get it? Okay, what's the big deal of calling you a he versus a she?
Right. Well, pronouns and name change are basically when you say that you are going to acknowledge that, you're acknowledging the person and you're acknowledging that this is how they identify, this is who they are. So by saying, all right, I will call you by this, I will refer to you as this, you're saying, I see who you are, and I accept that, and I respect that.
And Mara, I want to finally ask you, what kind of support infrastructure exists for teens who might be depressed, might be thinking about this, might unfortunately be inspired in a negative way by seeing what just happened last weekend?
Yeah, there's actually quite a bit. Now, first of all, there is the internet where lots of communities have sprung up and lots of communities of trans youth who support each other, and I think that's really important. There's also the Trevor Project, which is a helpline both online and telephones. There is PFLAG for families. Mm-hmm. There are also youth support groups, queer youth support groups in a lot of cities now, and a lot of LGBT community centers in cities that have youth groups, places where people can find support from their peers and from their communities.
All right, Mara Keisling, Executive Director of the National Center for Transgender Equality, and Leo Sheng. Thank you both for joining us.
Thanks.
Thank you.